Why are we here? I know you've thought about it. We all have. What is our purpose? What is our destiny? We're born, if we're lucky, we reproduce, and then we die. Repeat that a few billion times, and you get from the first simple life forms on Earth to us. Ever since Darwin, scientists have been working on how we got here. But now they're asking a question we all seek the answer to. Why? Is all our wonderful complexity directed towards some greater goal? Do our lives have an ultimate purpose? To English biochemist Lee Cronan, everything exists for a reason. Even haggis, the bizarre sheep stomach dish that the Scots can't get enough of.
Haggis exists because it's the Scottish national dish and it's been refined for hundreds of years, and that has a lot of parallels with actually with biology.
3.5 billion years ago, the first living cell appeared. Before that, Earth was just a vast soup of chemicals. Why did those chemicals combine in just the right amounts, in just the right sequence, to become living things? Lee's convinced that it couldn't have been dumb luck. Just as a chef can't invent haggis by randomly throwing ingredients together. The invention of the haggis recipe required feedback.
So as information passed back over time, and the customer, if you like, is going, no, that's wrong, that's awful. And this gets better and better and better until we get to the perfect haggis.
Lee thinks the environment on early Earth played the role of the chef's customer.
What we think happens is there is a natural law of evolution that it refines the chemicals in steps over time, where we can go from this easy to start with to this very special dish.
If Lee is right, the forces of evolution were at work long before the first cell. Chemicals competed against other chemicals. To find out for sure, Lee thought, why not play God and try to evolve chemicals into life forms in the lab? This is a machine that simulates millions of years of chemical evolution in a matter of weeks. Lee starts with four simple chemicals that can be mixed in 17 million possible combinations.
So in the first step, the ingredients are selected by the machine, and then they are pumped into the wells here, and they make a random recipe. So they just select random amounts.
The machine then squirts out tiny blobs of each chemical cocktail into a water-filled petri dish.
It's videoing the actual droplet behavior. So it's looking at how much the droplets are moving. So that's one feature that we want. Another feature we're looking for is droplets that divide. So it's like replication. Another property we're looking for is droplets that can vibrate and sense the environment.
When the blobs show signs of life, that recipe is selected for replication, and the inferior recipes are destroyed. Then, with each generation, the machine makes small, random changes to the recipe. After several weeks of trial and error, Lee's chemical blobs come alive. They get mobile. They hunt and capture other droplets.
Oh, there was a fusion. Oh, it's done it. That's nice.
They even reproduce. If you found them outdoors, you would probably mistake them for little gelatinous life forms, even though they're not. At least, not yet.
The next thing we want to be able to do is to feed the droplets on their own so they can take food naturally from the environment and grow and get bigger and divide. And then we're really on the pathway to turn this random chemistry into living chemistry, into biology.
Evolutionary biologists say that DNA in genes gives life its foundational purpose, to survive and evolve to be better at surviving. But if Lee is right, DNA is not the only chemical that can exist for this purpose.
This is why we're really excited, because we can show that evolution can occur in the natural world without genetic material.
Lee believes we are here for a reason. A reason shared with all life forms and the chemicals that constitute them. To live, to survive, and to evolve.
Where there is energy and there is matter, chemistry transforms into biology over time. And this is a natural law.
At the deepest level, inside every cell in our body, we are driven by the never-ending struggle of chemicals to make copies of themselves. But if the only purpose of life is to make more chemicals, why did we ever become more complex than this? This guy can replicate dozens of times a day, reproducing its bag of chemicals far more efficiently than we can. And yet, here we are. What's the reason for bags of chemicals like you and me? Evolutionary biologist Richard Lenski at Michigan State University is a biological time traveler.
So any biologist would love to see the way the film of the life on Earth played out, and to actually watch the transitions that occurred over these several billion years. And ask, why did it work out the way it did?
Richard doesn't have billions of years to watch evolution in action, but he does have the span of one lifetime, which he has dedicated to performing the longest evolutionary experiment in the history of science. 27 years ago, Richard plucked 12 genetically identical E. coli bacteria from a container and allowed them to start their own populations in 12 separate worlds. Ever since, day after day, he's watched each of the 12 populations multiply and compete amongst themselves for a limited amount of food.
Key part of the experiment is just keeping it going day after day after day, transferring a small amount from each flask into fresh medium each day, and the bacteria grow and replicate in that fresh medium until they run out of the sugar that they grow on, and then they sit there until the next day that whole process is repeated.
At the end of every day, he allowed a small sample of the survivors to continue producing new generations. Year after year, the daily process went on and on. In each flask, the cells of bacteria replicate, passing on tiny random mutations to their offspring's DNA. For the first 15 years of the experiment, the separated populations evolved pretty much in lockstep, each strain gradually adapting to this flask environment. But one night, one of the colonies had a sudden and dramatic victory in the arms race of evolution.
One day, we came in and found that one of our flasks had many more bacteria than the others. One of the lines of bacteria, after they'd finished the glucose, they said, there's something else to eat. And that gave them a huge advantage.
Overnight, these E. coli had switched on new and complex internal machinery that allowed them to extract energy from a benign chemical additive. Armed with this new talent, they vanquished their competitors. But when Richard examined the DNA of these E. coli, he realized that the mutation that switched on the new talent was merely the last in a long series. The others had lain dormant for thousands of generations.